Let's go ahead and get started for today. Thanks again so much for coming. And today we will come back to some of the big questions that we posed during the very first lecture about neutrinos, what they might have to do with the existence of the universe, and how an effect called CP violation might help to explain that. So just as a reminder, there's a little lecture next week on May 26th. So the next time we'll be back here will be June 2nd for the final lecture and brunch. So make sure not to come next week. Okay, so coming back to some ideas we discussed in the very first lecture. We have the universe, which is full of matter. And as natural as that might seem, this is a bit of a head-scratcher for physicists. How the universe is full of matter and not antimatter, or just a bunch of energy. We're perplexed by this because nature likes balance, and to us this looks like a big imbalance. So we know from Einstein that we have an equivalency between matter and energy, and we can convert between one and the other. And so in the early universe, right after the Big Bang, we have a ton of energy to work with. And so we can, out of that energy, produce matter and antimatter, pairs of particles and antiparticles, through this process of pair production, where we're going to convert energy into matter and antimatter. And then all that matter and antimatter that we create will undergo pair annihilation, where a particle finds its antiparticle and annihilates, turning back into energy. And so we expect, given what we know about the laws of physics, that nature is going to be in balance and will give birth to all of these particles and antiparticles. They will find their nemesis and annihilate. And so we end up with just energy at the end once things have balanced out. So in other words, we produce equal parts matter and antimatter. It goes and everything is in equilibrium, annihilates, and we're left over with a universe that's full of nothing but energy in the form of a bunch of photons flying around. This is, of course, very different from the universe we see, which is full of galaxies and stars and planets and things. So what appears to have happened sometime in the early universe is that we produce this matter and antimatter, and somehow we get a slight excess in matter over antimatter. And so when the dust settles and all the cancellation is done, what we're left with is a universe that's full of a bunch of energy, and then kind of the extra bit, what's left over that didn't cancel out of this matter, which is in the form of baryons, things like protons and neutrons, that are going to go and make up atomic nuclei. And so that little bit of leftovers from this cancellation process goes on and gives rise to everything we see in the universe today. And again, this is a bit of a mystery because nature likes to be in balance, and so we need to somehow produce this imbalance, this excess of matter relative to antimatter in order to explain this. And so this was understood basically as soon as matter and antimatter were proposed, and people were saying, where's all the antimatter, basically? So this got some really solid theoretical footing in 1967, a physicist named Andrei Sakharov. He came up with a list of rules that you need, so conditions that have to be met in order to create this imbalance in the early universe. And so these three rules are first that you have to have non-conservation of baryon number. This means that there has to be some process that can start from no protons and neutrons and end up with some protons and neutrons. So that's sort of a given. We're going to go from equal parts matter and antimatter and end up with this excess of matter. The next bit is that some of the fundamental symmetries in the standard model of particle physics have to be broken. These are what's called the C and CP symmetry. We'll discuss those in a moment. And the final bit is that these reactions that produce this excess have to happen out of thermal equilibrium. So they have to be happening at such a rate that, relative to the rate of expansion of the universe, that in the end you don't just have everything just cancel out. So at some point this excess has to get frozen in. As a historical note, so Andrei Sakharov is a really interesting fellow in the history of physics. when I was talking about supernova neutrinos, and I said that the supernova is a billion, billion, billion times the most powerful nuclear bomb ever tested. The most powerful nuclear bomb ever tested, in fact, that I was comparing to, was called the Tsar Bomba. It was detonated by the Russians during the Cold War, and largely based on the work of Andrei Sakharov, who was a physicist in Russia at the time. However, he's actually one of the rare physicists who has the distinction of holding a Nobel Peace Prize. This is because later in his career, he really went on to be a great humanitarian and really think hard about how society would deal with the nuclear age. So he received a Nobel Peace Prize for his work on that. So a very interesting fellow, Sakharov. In any case, he kind of gave us the recipe that we need in terms of how the laws of physics can give us this balance when generally nature would prefer balance. So a critical ingredient of that is this violation of one of these fundamental symmetries in the standard model. So that is CP and CP, which are what's called discrete symmetries in the standard model. And these are just mathematical operations that we can do to the particles that we have. So C just stands for charge. It means we just change the sign of the charge for a particle. So if you have a positively charged particle, you make it negatively charged. P is for parity. This means that you flip the coordinates of a particle. So if you take the x, y, z of some particle, you just flip it inside out. So these are just things you can do in the math to the standard model of particles. For an example of that, we'll consider such a particle. So let's take an electron, which has a negative charge, and let's say it's left-handed, meaning that its spin is aligned opposite to its direction of motion. So if we apply these charge and parity operations together, it's called CP, that changes the charge, so now it's a positively charged thing. And because we've flipped its coordinates, now it looks like it's going the other way, so we've changed it from a left-handed thing into a right-handed thing. So we have a positively charged right-handed particle, which I can think of one. That's just a positron. And so what the CP operation does, mathematically, is to just change a particle into an antiparticle, or vice versa.
So are all positrons right-handed?
So there's the question is whether all positrons are right-handed. So I've been a little bit vague about this. There's a fundamental property of the positron that will always be right-handed. That's called the chirality, which is related to the helicity that I talked about, which is the orientation of the spin relative to the direction of motion. But it doesn't depend on your frame of reference. So it's a fundamental property of the particle that's unchanging. So you can't outrun it and change it into something else. That's a subtle distinction, but an important one. So just like you can apply this operation to a particle and change it into an antiparticle, we can apply that to any reaction in the standard model. So say we consider neutrino oscillations, like muon-type neutrinos oscillating into electron-type neutrinos, and apply the CP operation to that, change the charge and change the parity. That just turns things into their antiparticles. And so what we call the CP mirror of this process is muon anti-neutrinos oscillating into electron-type anti-neutrinos. It is the same process, just for anti-neutrinos instead. But it's an experimental question whether this process and this process really happened identically. In this case, whether muon neutrinos and muon anti-neutrinos have oscillations that look just the same. And so, if this is true, if that holds, that anti-neutrino oscillations and neutrino oscillations look exactly the same, we say that the CP symmetry is conserved. And if that's not true, then we say that the CP symmetry is broken, or that we have CP violation, or CP. And so that's an experimental question. So the standard model allows for differences between neutrino and anti-neutrino oscillations, but we don't know whether nature chooses to exercise that option. We do know, based on experiments in the mid-1960s, that CP violation occurs at a small level for quarks. So these are the constituent parts that make up protons and neutrons. And in that case, the particles and antiparticles do act a little bit differently. So that was discovered in 1964 by experiments by Jim Cronin and Val Fish. But we don't know at this point whether neutrinos do this as well. So that's a big open question. So if we're talking about neutrino oscillations, to just do a very brief recap of what we know about that story. So I've shown you before, we have this formula that we can work out. Given any kind of neutrino represented by the alpha, we can say what the probability is that it ends up as a different kind of neutrino, beta. And that probability is given by, what's in purple here, these are just fundamental properties of constants of nature that we go out and measure. The overall probability represented by this term, and the difference in the neutrino masses, delta m squared. And then in your particular experiment, you should know what the distance traveled is and what the neutrino energy is. And so you can play these against each other and try to measure these things. And over the course of decades, many neutrino experiments from atmospheric neutrinos produced in the atmosphere by cosmic ray interactions, reactor antineutrinos, solar neutrino experiments, as well as accelerator-based neutrino experiments. We measure all the parameters that we need to know to tell us how neutrinos oscillate from one type to another, with the exception of this one parameter delta right there, which is kind of the last unknown in this model. And it's there that we could introduce the CP violation, these differences between neutrinos and antineutrinos velocity. So the hunt is on for that. Yes, sir?
How come that's complex and the other ones aren't? The E to the I.
Oh, yeah, the question is why that's complex. Yeah. So this is just one particular way that it's parameterized as some angles in a complex phase. There could be other ways to do that. So the hunt is on for these CP violations in neutrinos, and it's a very tricky business. So this formula that I showed you is really an approximate form. So here we're only considering two neutrinos at once and saying that the effect of having three neutrinos oscillating, we can ignore. Which, if you want to look for this CP violation effect, you can't get away with that. So things get way more complicated. So the probability of the muon neutrino changes into an electron neutrino is just a big mess now. And this isn't even the whole story. This is just the main effects. So it's tractable, but challenging. So first of all, now all the different parameters matter. So everything in that matrix you have to consider. So you wouldn't be able to do this until you've already measured all that. So it's a good thing you measured all that. All these terms here that look kind of like are due to matter effects. This is the impact that if you're sending neutrinos through matter, that will have an influence on how they oscillate, like it does for solar neutrinos coming out of the sun. This big mass of electrons influences how those neutrinos change type. And the same will be true if you send neutrinos through the Earth to do this experiment. So you have to understand all those processes as well, because of the influence of matter on neutrino interactions. And then finally, this delta parameter, this parameter that allows neutrinos and antineutrinos to oscillate differently as a result of a CP violation is over here. If that's zero, it just means neutrinos and antineutrinos work just the same. If it's not zero, it introduces a difference. And so what makes this experiment really tricky is that both the matter effects and this delta CP will cause differences in how the neutrinos oscillate relative to the antineutrinos. And so you have to be able to really understand this in order to measure that, to be able to disentangle these things. So it's a tricky business. But, with all that in hand, basically this is the experiment that you'd like to do. You create a beam of muon-type neutrinos, and then send them some long distance and look for them to change into electron-type neutrinos. If your distance is, say, 700 kilometers, or something, you have electron neutrinos showing up. You do that, you study your muon-type neutrinos, and then you switch over and do the same thing with muon anti-neutrinos. And you see what happens here, 700 kilometers away, for your electron anti-neutrinos that are appearing, and see whether there are any differences in the oscillations between the muon neutrinos and the muon anti-neutrinos. Right answer the question, do anti-neutrinos and neutrinos act the same? So, now we are all experts on CP violations in the neutrino sector, but I think we've gone a bit far afield from what this has to do with the origin of the universe. So, let's come back to that and discuss this process called baryogenesis. This is, you're going to give birth to these baryons, this excess of matter. And so our story starts with our discussion a few weeks ago of Majorana neutrinos. So we were thinking about what the difference is between neutrinos and anti-neutrinos. And we came up with two different possibilities for how we could handle neutrinos in a standard model. The first case is what's called a Dirac baryon, where we have a neutrino and an anti-neutrino, and those are a distinct object, a distinct particle and anti-particle. And each of those can come in either a left-handed form, spin aligned with the anti-aligned with the motion, spin is opposite the motion, or a right-handed form, where the spin is aligned with the motion. And as it happens, only the weak interaction knows about handedness, and so it will only interact with the left-handed neutrinos and right-handed anti-neutrinos. So we have these other two states that don't interact with them. Okay. The other option is the Majorana neutrinos, where the particle and antiparticle are one and the same. There's just one particle, one neutrino, that comes in a right-handed and left-handed form. So here the bookkeeping works out all the same. We can still explain all the phenomena that we see, but it's a bit more economical in that we don't have these extra non-interacting particles sitting around. So one of the main theoretical advantages, or something that people really like about the Majorana neutrino, is that it helps us to explain why the neutrino mass is so weirdly small. So the neutrino masses, we haven't measured them yet, but we know that they're many orders of magnitude lighter than all the other standard model particles, which seems strange. There's everything else, this big desert, and then the neutrinos, way lighter. And the idea here, which I touched on very briefly a few weeks ago, is what's called the seesaw mechanism. And the idea is that we have this super light neutrino, but it's accompanied by a brand new particle that we're going to add into the model, which is a really, really heavy neutrino, which I represent N. This is our neutrino's heavy new pound. And the idea with the seesaw mechanism is that the very light neutrino and this new, very heavy neutrino come together in a standard model and sort of balance each other out. So taken together as an object, they have a mass that's very similar to the other standard model particles. So we have a super light thing, and some thing that's as crazy heavy as the regular neutrino is crazy light. And they sort of balance each other out, explaining at some level what's with the very light neutrino masses. And so the way this works with these extra neutrinos in the math of the standard model is that you start out with some Dirac-type neutrinos. So you have four neutrinos who are only two of them interact, and they have masses typical of the rest of the particles. And then when you make them into Majorana neutrinos, so you're adding this Majorana-type mass, it causes a split. And we end up with some very light neutrinos. These are the ones we've been working with the whole time. And then these very heavy neutrinos. So these are now many orders of magnitude heavier than the rest of the standard model particles. And so these would be way too heavy to produce in any sort of particle accelerator. And so we never would have been able to observe these in experiments yet. So they can kind of hide from us in that sense. But taken together, the light ones and the heavy ones balance out to kind of restore some sense to the standard model. To take it a step further, in the standard model, the seesaw neutrinos, so the heavy ones and the light ones, have masses like any other particle in the standard model. And they get masses through interactions with the Higgs boson. And the light neutrinos, the ones that we've been working with, are the panel. They're the lightest things, so there's nothing lighter that they can decay into, so they're stable. The heavy ones, these new N, on the other hand, are heavy, and they will be unstable, and can decay into other stuff, to lighter things. In particular, so one of these could decay into, say, a positron and a Higgs boson, or an electron and a Higgs boson, neutrinos and Higgs bosons. So they could decay into other stuff. Leptons, anti-leptons, so they could decay into matter and antimatter. And the way I've written this, these reactions here on the left and these reactions here on the right are just the CP mirrors of one another. So these are just flipping the particles and antiparticles. So here I've just taken a positron and switched it into an electron. So I said these particles are way too heavy to ever produce in a particle accelerator, so we can't make them here on Earth. But in that greatest of particle accelerators, the early universe, we have all this energy kicking around. Tons of these heavy N neutrinos would get produced, pair-produced, in the early universe, just like everything is.
So do we know for sure the Higgs boson has an antiparticle? Or is that projected or estimated?
So the question is whether the Higgs boson has an antiparticle. That's the current theory in the standard model.
Okay.
So that there could be more to the Higgs, but that's where we're at. Right, so we'll produce a bunch of these heavy neutrinos in the early universe when we have the energy to do it. And so the question then is, we come back to the CP violation, whether neutrinos and antineutrinos work the same. So in this case, we have these K's of these heavy neutrinos going into, say, positrons or electrons. And if there's CP violation, these could happen at different rates. So it would create some asymmetry. So if we have, say, this decay happening more often than this decay, we produce more electrons than positrons. So we get some excess of matter in the form of electrons relative to antimatter, the positrons. So that's the start. But what we need to explain the universe is not an excess of electrons, but an excess of baryons, like nuclei and things. So there's one more step we need to do. And that brings us to what's called leptogenesis, which is the creation of this excess through leptons, things like electrons. So from these neutrino decays, from these heavy neutrinos we invented based on the seesaw mechanism, we think we can get an excess of leptons. So we can create an imbalance in the number of leptons versus anti-leptons. And then, conveniently, the standard model actually already gives us a process, sort of a mathematical sleight of hand, called the Spaleron process, which gives us a way to reshuffle an excess of electrons into an excess of baryons. So this is a process only available when there's a huge amount of energy present, such as the early universe, that doesn't conserve lepton number or baryon number. It just conserves their difference. And so this is sort of a, you throw a bunch of leptons in a bag and shake it up, and now we have unequal numbers of baryons and leptons. And so that's kind of the final piece of the puzzle that we need to create this excess of baryons that gives us the matter-antimatter asymmetry. So that was quite a story that I've just woven. So let's try to recap that. Say how we get from this question that we started out with and try to explain why we have this universe that's apparently full of matter and not antimatter. So step one, we recognize that we need to create a matter-antimatter imbalance in the form of an asymmetry where we have more baryons than antibaryons. So they all cancel out. We have some baryons left over that could go and make galaxies and things. Andrei Sakharov tells us what we need, what the ingredients are in order to do that with our current physical laws. So we need the CP violation mean, neutrinos or particles and antiparticles to behave differently in order to create such an asymmetry. We've known since the 60s that the CP violation, particles and antiparticles behaving differently, occurs in the quarks, but it's not enough to explain the excess of matter that we see in the universe. So we turn to the neutrinos, where we don't know yet, and ask whether there's CP violation in that case, which could help us out. We went through this whole exercise with the seesaw mechanism and these Majorana neutrinos, which would give us some heavy neutrinos created in the early universe, which can decay. Those decays could produce an imbalance in the number of leptons that they produce, so say more electrons than positrons, for example. And then we have this standard model process which can convert that imbalance into an imbalance of protons and neutrons. And with that, we reach the end and we can have a universe of all that. So, if I was a bit vague in the first lecture about how neutrinos can help explain the origin of the universe, I think you could see why at this point, because we've had to really take pieces of every single past lecture to create the story that could explain, which is really our best idea we have right now of why we have a universe full of matter. The linchpin of this, what you need to have all this hang together, is CP violation and neutrinos. And we don't know whether that occurs or not. We don't know whether neutrinos and antineutrinos behave the same or differently. And for this to work at all, they have to behave a little bit differently. Yes?
If you have CP violation, then you have to have T violation as well.
Mm-hmm.
Keep that CPT going.
Right.
How does anybody detect the time reversal symmetry failure?
So the question is, very insightful question. We have CP violation, but there's another additional symmetry in the standard model that's where you reverse time. It's the time reversal symmetry. And if you take all three of those together, CP and T, so charge, parity, and time, as far as we know, that's like a fundamental building block of the standard model. So that has to be preserved. And so if you have CP violation, it implies that you have to also violate the time reversal symmetry in order for the whole thing to be balanced. So the experimental searches generally focus on CP and on the T violations applied.
Right, easy to measure.
Sure. Hard to flip time. So since we need the CP violation for this whole story to hang together, the rest of the talk will focus on the hunt for CP violation and neutrinos. So again, schematically, the experiment that we want to do to search for this is to do a neutrino oscillation experiment. We'll make a beam of, say, muon neutrinos and muon antineutrinos, and then build our kind of canonical neutrino experiment where we have a near detector and a far detector. This measures what the beam starts out with, and then we look for oscillations down here. In this case, the appearance of electron neutrinos or antineutrinos. So we build this far detector at a spot, we know the L, where the oscillations we maximize, so we're getting a whole bunch of electron neutrinos showing up. And then we look at the distributions of energy to see whether the neutrinos and antineutrinos are doing anything different. To illustrate that in a bit more detail, so basically we fire these neutrinos away to the far detector, and then we look for these wiggles in the energy distribution of what shows up. I'll first draw your attention to the solid thick black line here, shown both for neutrinos and antineutrinos. And this is what you get if this parameter theta 1,3 is 0. So I made a big deal a few weeks ago about these reactor neutrino experiments that were trying to measure the last unknown parameter in the neutrino oscillations, theta 1,3. And this is why that was such a big deal. Because if theta 1,3 was tiny or 0, then you don't get any wiggles here at all. There's nothing to look for. You can't even do this experiment. So the fact that they went and measured theta 1,3 and that it was bigger than anyone expected was really good news because it makes these wiggles bigger than anyone had hoped for and makes its effect easier to look for. So that was great news, and it really highlights the importance of those reactor anti-neutrino experiments, you know, that have happened in the last decade or so. So since we know that's not an issue, what we look for is we shoot neutrinos, and we shoot our anti-neutrinos, and we look at the energies of what shows up, and oscillations induce these wiggles. And the red curve there is what you would expect to see in the case that there's no CP violation. And neutrinos and anti-neutrinos are going to behave just the same. And if CP violation happens, it can make the neutrinos go up in the blue and down for the anti-neutrinos. So it could be a shift there. Or it can make this go down for the neutrinos and up for the anti-neutrinos. So CP violation is going to induce a difference in the way that neutrinos and anti-neutrinos show up at this far away detector. So that's it. We just have to make our beam, look at our events that occur, and see whether they're, you know, follow which curve here they follow. And look for this kind of shift one way or the other to see whether neutrinos and anti-neutrinos are acting differently. Simple enough, right? So there's a couple of effects that conspire to make this experiment extremely difficult to do. Which I'll touch on a few of. So the first is these matter effects that I spoke of earlier. So what we'd really like to do is have we make our beam of neutrinos and fire it through the Earth to our detector, and then we'd like to make a beam of anti-neutrinos, fire it through an anti-Earth to our anti-detector. Then we have an Earth and a detector made out of antimatter. And then this wouldn't be an issue. But the fact is that the Earth is made of atoms and things which are matter. And so that will cause the matter effects, the influence of matter on neutrino oscillations, to be different for neutrinos and anti-neutrinos. So that's well understood stuff, kind of mundane explanation for why neutrinos and anti-neutrinos might behave differently. That has nothing to do with CP violation. And so if we do this experiment and measure the difference between neutrinos and anti-neutrinos, we need to be really sure that that isn't due to these matter effects, that it really is due to CP violation if we're going to say anything about that. And so these all have to be well understood before we can make any claims about CP violation. As it happens, this effect actually depends on the neutrino mass ordering, whether the neutrino masses have a little split and then a big split, or a big split and then a little split, which is currently unknown how that goes. And so this experiment, we need to actually measure that at the same time in order to make sure that that all goes into these predictions correctly, and we understand those differences between neutrinos and anti-neutrinos. So that's challenge number one. Another thing, from just last week, we had these sterile neutrinos, right? So this is these extra kinds of neutrinos, a fourth kind of neutrino that doesn't interact normally with matter, so it doesn't do weak interactions, but it still oscillates with the other neutrinos. So we now have not three neutrino oscillations, but four neutrino oscillations to contend with. And we have some fairly strong evidence from a set of experiments, LSD, mini-boom, these solar neutrino experiments in gallium, as well as experiments at nuclear reactors, that all show evidence that we have this extra neutrino that we need to add in. In the meantime, there's a whole bunch of experiments that have strong evidence that there's no such thing. So we have a lot of tension in the data right now regarding these sterile neutrinos. We have a whole program at Outer Fermi Lab designed just to measure this. But we basically have two options as far as the CP violation searches are concerned. Option one is that sterile neutrinos are there, that these effects are real, and so now we have to worry about neutrino oscillations, not with three, but with four neutrinos, and that formula that I showed you gets even more complicated. So that's a wrench in the works, but if we can go and measure how these sterile neutrinos work, that's something we can deal with. The other option is that there's something we're not understanding about how neutrinos interact with matter, and that's the explanation for these things. All right, so if that's the case, if there aren't sterile neutrinos out there, We would really like to understand this and improve our models of neutrino interactions to the point where we can explain all of this. And really, only then will we feel confident that if we see something weird with neutrinos and antineutrinos acting differently, that we can really say that this is a CP violation and not just some misunderstanding of neutrino interactions. So we need to sort this out one way or another before we can really say we've seen the CP violation. A further complication is these neutrino interactions themselves, which are really challenging to understand. The principle of any neutrino oscillation search is that you're looking for these changes in the neutrino type. You know the distance from your detector to the source pretty well. You're trying to measure these parameters that control the oscillation, so the overall probability and the distance scale over which the wavelength of the oscillations occur. But to make that inference and measure these things, you need to know the energy of a neutrino, which, it turns out, is really hard to do. So first of all, we can't produce a beam of neutrinos that all have a constant energy. It's just not possible to do. And so when we produce a beam of neutrinos, we get a bunch of neutrinos that have a very broad range of energies. And for any given neutrino coming out of this beam, we don't know what its energy was. And we try to measure it, but you can't measure a neutrino. You can only measure what comes out when a neutrino runs into something. So that's how our detectors work. So a neutrino of unknown energy comes into our detector, crashes into a nucleus, and a bunch of stuff comes flying out. And so we're trying to use the stuff that comes flying out to infer what the type of the neutrino was and what its energy was. And in a simple case where we had just, say you just had a neutron floating in free space, and a neutrino comes and smacks into it, and stuff goes flying out, we can pretty much calculate exactly what happens in that case. As soon as that neutron is bound inside a nucleus, so it's bouncing off of other protons and neutrons, exchanging energy, in this really complicated bound system, we can no longer analytically calculate what happens in that case. So people are pushing the envelope with huge supercomputers trying to calculate these things. It's a really hard problem. And so the processes inside nuclei make it really hard to measure what the neutrino energy is. There's a bit of a joke in the industry, if you're familiar with the Fight Club movie. This is a sign that's hanging up outside an office at Fermilab. The first rule of neutrino nucleus scattering, don't talk about the nucleus. Nuclear physics is really, really hard and really complicates things, and it makes it really difficult to measure the energy of the neutrino, which you need to know in order to work out the math here and measure these parameters, these unknowns. But joking aside, this is a real fundamental challenge for the community, and so there's a huge theoretical effort, the theorists, doing better and better calculations to try to, from first principles, understand how these processes happen. And on the other side, we do much more detailed experimental measurements. Basically, we do the experiment, we smash neutrinos into stuff and see what comes out, and try to understand things better experimentally. And a big piece of that effort is a detector we met last week, SBND, the short baseline near detector, which is the first detector in this short baseline neutrino program, searching for sterile neutrinos, right over at Fermilab. But it has sort of a dual purpose. It's right next to the target where the neutrinos are created, so it has tons of neutrinos going through it all the time, interacting, and so we'll have a very large number of events we can study. And so SBND, in addition to being a crucial part of this search for sterile neutrinos, will also give us very detailed measurements of how neutrinos interact with matter, which will then feed into these searches for CP violation, where you need really good precision. And so we'll learn a lot about how to measure the energy of a neutrino, thanks to SBND. So onward to the CP violation searches. The experiments that are getting underway now, there's two huge international efforts that are both trying to solve this really critical problem. And those are one in the U.S. called DOE, the Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment, which is based on liquid argon time projection chambers. And then another experiment in Japan called Paper Kamio Kande. Remember we had Kamio Kande, the first detector looking at atmospheric neutrino oscillation. And then there was Super Kamio Kande, much bigger, looking at atmospheric and solar neutrinos. And this is the next bigger one, Hyper Kamio Kande. I don't know what comes next. So since we are involved with this DOE experiment, I'll focus on that for the rest of the talk. And the basic idea with DOE, the Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment, is we make a beam of neutrinos, a very powerful beam, at Fermilab, and then we shoot it through 800 miles of the Earth to a waiting neutrino detector. We do that for neutrinos, we do it for anti-neutrinos, we see if they act the same. So there's a really nice video that the DOE folks have put together with an overview of the experiment. So it's 2 minutes long, so I'll flip over to that.
This is Fermilab, a Department of Energy National Laboratory near Chicago. It's the starting place for the Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment, DOOM, powered by the Long Baseline Neutrino Facility, LBNF. The experiment begins with Fermilab's accelerator complex, which moves protons close to the speed of light. It's all part of an effort by more than 1,000 scientists from around the world to figure out how tiny particles called neutrinos work, and what role they play in the evolution of our universe. Neutrinos are the most abundant matter particles in the cosmos, but very hard to catch. Trillions stream through you every second without leaving a trace. At LBNF, the beam of protons will smash into a target, creating the most intense beam of neutrinos in the world. Scientists will collect data to measure properties of neutrinos close to the source and again far away. Neutrinos change as they travel, so scientists are sending them straight through 1,300 kilometers of rock toward the DOOM detectors at the Stanford Underground Research Facility in South Dakota. The detectors can also look for the birth of neutron stars and black holes by catching neutrinos from exploding stars. The 1.5 kilometer deep detectors will be filled with 70,000 tons of liquid argon, making them the largest neutrino detectors in the world. As neutrinos interact with the cold liquid, they create a shower of other particles and light. Those particle tracks are then picked up by electronics and transmitted as data to the surface. The information will be analyzed by scientists at collaborating institutions in countries around the world. They'll use this data to solve unanswered questions about neutrinos, and maybe even figure out why matter exists. Things like planets, stars, and even here. There's a new beam in town. We've had to zoom out. So this is the
new theme for the long baseline neutrino program, which is this program involving Dune. So we're building a brand new, even more powerful proton linear accelerator, which goes over here. That injects its protons into that same booster where they get an additional kick and energy. And then from there, they don't go straight to the target. They go into this even bigger particle accelerator called the main injector, where they go even higher in energy, even closer to the speed of light. And they finally get smashed into a target, which is being built over there, that probe. This is a new high-powered neutrino beam being built at Fermilab. It's powerful, it's tunable, and it makes your choice of neutrinos or antineutrinos just what you want to do, a world-leading search for CV violation. So this is an extremely powerful accelerator, and really they're having to invent the technology to do it as they go along. So there's a lot of R&D happening right now, and then construction begins in the next decade, in around 2024. So after these protons have been accelerated up to very high energy to make their way to this target there, and what happens next is in this target complex, we're going to turn that proton beam into a beam of neutrinos. So we have that proton beam come in from this side, goes up a little hill, so that it can be pointed down into the Earth. And in that first box there, the target hull complex, it smashes into a metallic target, and gives off sort of a spray of other elementary particles, charged particles. Those then enter this K-pipe, which is a 200-meter-long empty pipe, and that's just there to give these charged particles that came out of the target a chance to decay into neutrinos. So some of them will. They'll decay inside this pipe. The stuff that doesn't decay just runs into the wall at the end, the absorber. And then the neutrinos just, they don't care, they just keep on going through the rough. The last step here, right there, is a near detector. But just like we did for the short baseline program, there's a near detector right after the neutrinos are created. It's going to check things out, measure the energies of these neutrinos, their type, and really look at the composition of the beam, so that we know later on what's changed. So these neutrinos going off into the rock, make their way to a trip to beautiful South Dakota. Neutrinos love vacations in South Dakota. They're familiar with bison. There's a lot of bison in Fermilab. And so what's waiting in South Dakota for these neutrinos is an underground laboratory called the Sanford Underground Research Facility, or CERF. So this is under construction now. There's already a few experiments that are located there, and they're expanding it. So it's this huge underground complex. It's about 4,850 feet deep, so almost a mile deep, underground, in an old gold mine. So this is the Homestake Gold Mine, which is of some historical note for neutrinos. This is actually where Ray Davis built his neutrino experiment, his solar neutrino detector, that originally discovered the solar neutrino problem. It was in this very same mine before it was a big experimental facility. So at that point, it was still a working gold mine. And after that experiment was finished, they finished up their mining operations, and then it was, they were sort of over there, and then they took it over and started turning it into this big research laboratory. There's all kinds of science going on there. So this is located a little out of the way, in the beautiful Black Hills of South Dakota. So this is, there are actually two different shafts that go down to the underground area. So this is standing at one of those and looking at the other one. So this is the Ross shaft, standing at the U shaft, looking at that. It's quite a beautiful area. Out there in Leeds, South Dakota. And somewhat funnily, here's the obligatory selfie at the Yates shaft, where you can see it all decked out in a coverall and a headlamp, and that's the elevator behind me to go down. So it's very, very much true to its roots as a mine. as it becomes a world-class scientific facility. And so what's there is the dune architecture, where these neutrinos are going to get detected, and so we can look for the neutrino anti-neutrino differences that would indicate CP violation. The dune is a huge liquid argon time projection chamber. So we met a few of these kinds of detectors last week. It's sort of a brand new detector technology. And so all of the short baseline neutrino program detectors are liquid argon TPCs, SPMD, microboom, and ARIS. As a brief reminder of how these things work, you take a big tank of liquefied argon, it's very cold, a charged particle can go through it, like a muon. As it goes through, it rips off electrons from the argon atoms. We put a very strong electric field across the detector, which then pulls the electrons across. And when we have some wires at the side, and when they hit the wires, the electrons hit the wires, they create little electrical pulses. Based on those electrical pulses, we can then get a 3D image of what the neutrino interaction was. And so we use that to measure what type of neutrino interacted, what type of interaction it was based on the particles that came out, and what the neutrino energy was. So that gives us the detailed way to measure the neutrino energy, which is so critical for a precision experiment. So the dune detectors are by far the largest such detectors that have ever been considered. Altogether, dune is, as the video says, 70,000 tons of liquid argon. And that's divided into four modules here, just to make it a little easier to build in a modular way. And so each of these time projection chambers, the detectors, is 40 feet tall, 45 feet wide, and 170 feet long. So like much bigger than this room. Each of these modules is about 3.5 Olympic-sized swimming pools full of liquid argon for a bit of scale, although no swimming. Quite cold, -300 degrees Fahrenheit. And so the idea is you build these huge liquid argon time projection chambers and you look for the wheels. Just to give another idea of the sense of scale for this thing, currently the biggest such detector that exists is Icarus, the FAR detector for the short baseline program, which I showed you last week. It sits in this gigantic red box, which is the size of a building. So that, by all rights, is big. That's less than a 20th of a single module. So this is just, you know, quite the scale. But neutrinos interact so rarely, they're so far away, you need a big detector to be able to catch the world. And so we would like to convince ourselves that we know how to scale up from something this size to something this size. And so we've been building some small prototypes out of CERN in Switzerland. So here are the small prototypes. That's what a small prototype looks like. The detector is the size of a warehouse. And the red boxes here are the cryostats that hold the liquid argon. So if you look inside one of those, there's what's inside. This ridgy wall is the interior of the cryostat, so that's the vat that holds the liquid argon. And then this box in the middle is the actual time projection chamber. So that has the high voltage and these wires that give us the images. So this whole thing then gets filled up with liquid argon. So that's the prototype. Now to move to the real deal, obviously a big effort. And so that is now underway. As of July 2017, they had their formal groundbreaking. Lots of smiling faces there as things get going on the ground. And a really nice quote from that occasion from our Secretary of Energy, Rick Perry. He said, "The start of construction on this world-leading science experiment is cause for celebration, not just because of its positive impacts on the economy and on America's strong relationship with our international partners, but also because of the fantastic discoveries that await us beyond the next horizon." And I really like this because it highlights, you know, that this is not only about the science here, but the product of the scale, there's really a lot of fringe benefits that you get that come along with it. So to go from groundbreaking to breaking ground to groundbreaking science, I guess, here's the timeline. So 2018, this year, these prototype detectors get up and running at CERN. So there's actually, there's two red boxes I showed you, are two slightly different technologies for how the detector can operate. So those are going soon. 2021, we started installing the first of those four modules. And in 2023, the second module goes in. And those first two will be operational by 2024. So you will start running the detector, understanding how it works, collecting some data. And then the new beam at Fermilab is under construction at that point. It comes online in 2026. So at that point, we have neutrinos coming from Fermilab to South Dakota. Neutrinos, anti-neutrinos, and we commence the search for CP violation in neutrinos. So quite an effort. And, you know, it really takes an army to accomplish something like this. So the project is massive, not only in terms of the physical scale of the experiment, but also in terms of the human resources that you need to execute that. So this is a picture of a small subset of the Duke collaboration, which actually consists of over 1,000 physicists representing 32 nations and 175 different institutions around the world. We're all coming together to build this new experiment. So it really a huge effort of the whole community. And so what the bottom line is for June, what everyone is looking for, is again this CP violation in neutrinos, which has never been measured before, but is a crucial ingredient to the story of how we can use neutrinos to explain the matter-antimatter asymmetry that leads to the observable universe. So that's kind of the main event for Dune. There's also some very interesting other physics that Dune can do. It'll be a world-class detector for detecting supernovas. So fingers crossed for a good supernova while Dune is up and running. So we'll learn a lot about supernovas just based on what Dune will see.
Proton decay is what Dune, right?
Oh.
The final thing that Dune is looking for is for the decay of protons. So this has been something that people have searched for a long time. In the standard model, the proton is stable. It has to be pretty stable for us accuser to exist and be here to ask the question. But in many theories beyond the standard model, the proton is allowed to decay very rarely. And so, you know, people have searched for it, and then, you know, theoretically it gets rarer, and they can search for that, and then it gets rarer. So Dune will be capable of searching for that as well, an unprecedentedly sensitive search for these possible rare decays of protons that we predicted by theories of physics beyond the standard model. So these, and again, the main event though is this search for CP violation, looking for neutrinos and anti-neutrinos to oscillate through. So it's sort of like the science objectives, but I like to step back and, you know, to an even wider perspective to talk about what you get from an experiment like this. So, of course, this is pushing the boundaries of science and trying to address some of the grandest questions that one can ask, you know, like this idea of trying to understand the universe. And in the meantime, you'll notice that I've referenced every previous talk in this talk, and that's because we have to understand so much in order to make this precision measurement that this is a, you know, really driving discovery sort of across the board for neutrinos and particle physics. This just demands a better understanding than we have, and so it's really driving a huge amount of effort in physics beyond CP violation. Aside from the pure science aspects of it, the technology to build Dune really doesn't exist today. This is not something that you can go out and buy parts off the shelf and put together. So it's something that's never been attempted before. And so we also have to push the boundaries of technology and engineering to invent the things that we need to build Dune and make it successful. So this is things like the electronics instrumentation that will read out these pulses on these wires. That has to be developed. The sensor technology, the computing infrastructure that it will take to process all this data, the accelerator facility at Fermilab that's going to produce the neutrino beam, all technologies that are being invented as we speak. And we can't even begin to know what the applications of some of these things will be, you know, as they make their way into industry and everyday life. As a final this is a huge international undertaking where we're not only, you know, bringing some scientific leadership to the U.S., hosting this huge international program, really concentrating a lot of science and engineering knowledge here in the U.S. But as I mentioned, this is a very international effort with 175 institutions from 32 different countries, growing at this point. And so we're really building connections around the world, with many different benefits here at home. So I would say with something, the scope of this project, you learn something about CP violation, but you also get a whole lot more. And that, thank you. Yeah, the neutrinos just go straight through the rock. Yeah, so no. Oh, it's a disappointment to Elon Musk. I would have loved to go to that. Yeah, so they kind of point them down, and then they go through the rock of the Earth, and then they kind of pop up on the other side, right there. They do detect they're sitting in there.
How much are American taxpayers for this project?
Yeah, so the question is about the cost of the Dunes Dam, which is ballpark about $1 billion. I argue you get a lot of free money.
Cost.
Yes.
Two questions. If it decays, what do you think it decays into? Just some three quarks? And what is actually what's the biggest deal on proton decay?
Okay, yeah. So the question about proton decay, what it decays into, and what's the big deal? So it really depends on the particular theory of physics beyond the standard model of what proton would decay into. In some theories, it would just decay into neutrinos, which is clear.
Into the
trans? Yeah, so it vanishes. In a particular theory, that Dune is, I think, something worse. I think Dune will be sensitive to a number of different models. Another one is decaying into a kaon, which is a quark anti-quark pair particle that you can detect. And some neutrinos from what decay. So basically, in this case, it's producing some charged particle, which will then go flying out from the nucleus and decay into something else and decay into something else. And so that gives you the signature to be able to search for that, which is really probe for.
And now, what's the big deal? It's an important thing. They found out it decays a lot.
Yeah, right. So proton decay would apply a new way for the baryon number conservation to be violated in the standard model. So that has some fundamental symmetry aspects. And so in the current standard model, it's not possible for protons to decay. So they're sort of protected by that symmetry. So this would mean that the standard model is wrong. And so we need to know that one of these other theories has to be.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So it's sort of on, it's been kind of a long sought after and not found yet. But I think there's this theoretical motivation. It's some similar footing to neutrinos double beta decay, which violates electron number conservation. This is sort of the analog of that, that would violate baryon number conservation.
I just had a question about the sterile neutrino. If I understand it correctly, if it's only one candidate and it interacts with gravity but does not interact with the force, and so what is the implication of that as far as kids? In the early universe, would it not have and if that's the case, could that be something that is not affected by CP violation?
So the spiral units that they exist would have a mass, and so it would be interacting with all the sticks and standard picture.
But doesn't the weak force have to be involved?
Nothing.
No.
I think this is its own separate force. So as far as the CP violation, at least the light sterile neutrinos, you wouldn't have such a impact on that. You need to just extend things to decay asymmetrically. So it's a story with that.
Anyone not have any dreams of doing this on the moon? Really, these experiments here to the moon? Even painting from Earth to the far side of the moon? Do you have that on space and then the entire moon?
Yeah, the question is about a neutrino experiment on the moon. I would love to make the moon into a solar neutrino detector. The distance or the distance over which the oscillations occur is fixed by the mass splitting and the energy of the neutrinos. And so the mass splitting is, and so that's where it's, what the distance is you to build the ideal detector. So the mass splitting is just a constant of nature, so that's fixed by nature. The energy, we're limited in the energies that we can produce in a particle beam, and so that's more or less a given as well. And so with those constraints, it turns out that 1,300 kilometers or 800 miles is pretty close to the ideal for looking for the appearance of electron-type neutrinos. Had nature chosen differently and the mass splitting were different, then we might need to build something further away or what have you. But for this particular search, the 1,300 kilometers is really the ideal distance. So they basically found a mine as close as possible to 1,300 kilometers away and built a detector there.
Well, what does Elon Musk have to say about this?
I know, yeah. Elon Musk, I'm sure, would love to build a tunnel.
Yes, in the description of fermions and baryons, we know that there are constituents of each of those particles and quarks, and many of the quarks are anti-quarks. And would that account for some of the anti-matter? And if so, how much?
Oh, okay. Yeah, the question was about quarks accounting or anti-quarks accounting for the matter anti-matter asymmetry. So we have the bulk of the universe appears to be basically protons and neutrons, which are made of quarks. And so there are small numbers. There's certainly a small amount of antimatter in the universe at any given time. So there's charged particle hadrons that have a quark anti-quark pair, so those contain a little bit of antimatter. There's positrons that are produced in the case of nuclei, and they quickly find an electron on an island. So it's not to say that there's no antimatter in the universe, it's just tiny fractions of what we have in terms of matter. So we have a whole lot of atoms, but no anti-atoms that occur naturally. I keep saying one more. A short one. Okay.
You said neutrino would be influenced by the Higgs boson. Mm-hmm. How does the Higgs boson not only affect neutrino, but any matter is it another fifth force that has an exchange carrier to affect, slow down, or add to the mass of other particles?
Yeah, the question was how the Higgs influences matter. That's right. So the Higgs is essentially another force. So the Higgs boson is a carrier of a force that has its own interactions with all the matter particles. And so you can draw, like I draw diagrams of weak interactions, you can draw diagrams of the particles interacting with the Higgs boson, which is this kind of field that's everywhere for particles to interact with. And so then the question of mass becomes a matter of what the strength of that interaction is, how strongly coupled a given particle is to the Higgs field. And so that's a parameter of nature that sets the particle mass. We have no theoretical guidance really on what the number should be. And so we just measure the particle mass experimentally and use that to guess what this coupling is.
Any improvement in the standard model that can account for that, explain that.
Yeah, it would be great to